Amen. I'm going to read three verses of scripture from the book of Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 35 through 37. If you have your Bibles, you can read along with me. If not, just listen and hear the word from the Lord. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. That's a comforting passage of scripture for us in this time that we are going through. And so let us bow our heads in a moment of prayer together. Gracious God, our beloved Heavenly Father, we first of all give glory and honor and praise to your holy and righteous name. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that you blessed us to wake up this morning and to see another day. We thank you, dear God, that you watched over us as we slumbered and slept last night. And you kept away from us the angel of death so that our eyes could be opened this morning and we could see the sun rise once again. Lord, we just want to thank you for how you have brought us safe thus far through this coronavirus pandemic. We never know what is in front of us, but we're glad that we have made us safe thus far. And we pray that we will make it safe in the hours during this period of time. We lift up Mrs. Brenda Carter, our member, before you in prayer. And we ask you to comfort her heart and that of all her family members at the homegoing of her mother. God, can nobody keep us on this earth like you can. And so we rely on you. We count on you. And we just praise you and thank you for all that you've done for us, all you've been to us. Continue to see us through these troubled times and bring us safe and sound out on the other side. We look forward to the day when we can gather once again in the house of the Lord to worship you and to praise you. But until then, help us to hold on to your unchanging hand, knowing that because we are in your good hands, everything will be all right. So we give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. we're going to be teaching this morning, starting with the 8th chapter of the book of Romans, and we will finish the book going through the remaining chapters. And so let's go ahead and get started. If you have your Bibles, perhaps you can follow what we will be speaking of. We're going to start with some key concepts from the book of Romans, starting with the 8th chapter and going through. Paul, in this 8th chapter, talks about the carnal mind. And so the question that we want to raise this morning is, what does it mean to be carnally minded? Paul, when he was teaching the church at Corinth, he talked about the carnal mind. And he said that the carnal mind leads to death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So what is the carnal mind? Well, the carnal mind is a mind that is under the control of corrupt human nature. The carnal mind is a world-centered mind. People with a carnal mind look at things from a worldly point of view and not from a spiritual point of view. And the Bible tells us that the carnal mind is hostile and antagonistic toward God. It is not subject to the Word of God. So that those who are living by the carnal mind are living according to the laws of sin and corruption, of the corrupt human nature, and they cannot please God. That's in verse 10 of chapter 8. And if Christ is in you, then the natural human body is dead because of sin, but the Holy Spirit dwells in you, and the Holy Spirit gives you life because of righteousness. And in verses 13 through 18 of chapter 8, Paul says, for if you live according to the flesh, which is the carnal mind, that the flesh is the sinful, corrupt human nature. If you live according to that, you will die spiritually. But if you live by the Holy Spirit, you put to death the deeds of the carnal body, and therefore you will live. And this is a quote from Paul. For as many as are led by the Holy Spirit, these are the sons or the children of God. And that raises the second question. You know, some people say, well, we're all children of God. Well, that's a nice thought, but it's not biblical. The Bible defines who the children of God are. And here's the biblical reference. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. Okay. The children of God are those who have confessed that Jesus Christ is their Lord, and that they believe in their heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. All of those who believe that way are called the children or the people of God. Those who have not confessed Jesus Christ as Lord, or who do not believe that God has raised Jesus from the dead, are not children of God. Well, what are they called? They're called very simply creatures of God. So you see, there are two kinds of people. There are the children of God, then there are all the others who are creatures of God. All right. Now, Paul goes on to say that in verse 21, chapter 8, verse 21, the whole creation is in the bondage of corruption. What does that mean? Well, that means that when Adam disobeyed God and ate the forbidden fruit in the Garden of Eden, that not only did humankind fall into sin, but that the entire creation also fell into sin. Now, you know very well that everything eventually deteriorates, okay? No matter what it is. When we have clothes, our clothes wear out. When we have a home, we have to keep working on it because something is constantly breaking down. If we have a car, it may drive good for a while, but eventually, what's going to happen? Something is going to break down. And after the car has been around for a few years, it starts to rust out. That's because the entire creation is in corruption, and therefore it deteriorates. That's what Paul means by that when he says the whole creation is in the bondage of corruption. And the creation is waiting for the children of God to be revealed. Because once the children of God are revealed, then the creation itself will be renewed. There won't be no more rusting out. There won't be any more sickness. There won't be any more death and dying. There won't be any more aches and pains. You won't have to take no medicine for your joints or anything else, because sickness and affliction will be done away with. And so the creation is waiting for that. And when will the sons or the children of God be revealed? I'm glad to tell you that when Jesus comes in clouds of glory and the angel comes with him with the trumpet of God, and when Jesus gives the signal, the angel will blow the trumpet, and the trumpet shall sound across the entire earth. And the word tells us the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then those who are still living on the earth who are children of God will be caught up to join the Lord and the other saints in the air. And Jesus will lead the church into heaven, and the creation will be freed of the bondage of corruption. I don't know about you, but that sounds awfully good to me, and I'm looking forward to that day. And Paul says, the creation itself, in verse 21 and verse 22, Paul says, the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. And so, therefore, we can say today, thanks be to God, that God has a plan in place, that all the things that are out of joint now, and all of the things that go wrong in this life, God's got a plan to make everything right. And so one day we will see God's plan become completely fulfilled. It's being fulfilled now in stages, little by little, step by step, degree by degree. So slow that we have difficulty seeing it. But trust me when I tell you, God's plan is continuously being manifested and unveiled. And we have this word in verse 31 of chapter 8. Paul says, we should know, we are to know that all things, not some things, not many things, not most things, but all things work together for good for those who love God and those who are called according to God's purpose. And God's purpose is that none should perish, but that all should be saved. But unfortunately, all do not love God, and all do not obey God. And then the Apostle Paul gives that beautiful passage of scripture that I read at the beginning. What shall separate us from the love of Christ? And he names various things. And he concludes by saying, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Now we're going to move over to chapter 10. There are no particular teachings. There are details in chapter 9, but no particular concepts that could be considered a key concept. So I want to go over to chapter 10 and verses 9 and 10. This is critical for every believer to understand. Many people ask the question, they say, the Bible says you must be born again. Yes, it does. Jesus taught that in the Gospel of John that you must be born again. So many people have the question, how can I be born again? Well, I'm so glad that God answered that question for us through the Apostle Paul in the 10th chapter of the book of Romans, the verses 9 and 10. How can an unbeliever be born again? And this is what Paul says. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, then you are saved. And then verse 13 confirms that. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So that's how you get to be born again. You confess publicly with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and then you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. When you do that, you are saved. Now, please notice this. The Bible doesn't say a thing about how you feel. The Bible doesn't say you have to jump up and down and run up and down the church aisle. The Bible doesn't say you have to yell and scream. This thing is not based on emotions. You see, emotions are a part of the natural person. They come and they go. You can feel good one minute, and the next minute you can feel terrible. You can be smiling one minute, and the next minute you're frowning. So this thing is not based on your emotions. It's based on the Word of God. If you confess with your mouth publicly that Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, doesn't say a word about emotions. And so don't say, I didn't feel anything. It doesn't matter whether you felt something or not. It's not based on whether you feel something. It's based on faith in the Word of God and not upon your fickle feelings. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Here's another key concept. In chapter 10, verses 12 and 13, the Apostle Paul teaches. This is important, so please hear me real good. Most Christians don't know this, at least in my experience. All right. Christians are on the same spiritual level as the Jews, who are God's chosen people. Let me say that again. Now, we all know that the Jews are called God's chosen people. And so most people think that means that they are God's favorite people. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that the Jews are more favored than everybody else. It doesn't say that. It said God's chosen people. But Paul is teaching in chapter 10, verses 12 and 13, look it up, that Christian believers are on the same spiritual level with the spiritual Jews. A lot of folks don't know that. A lot of folks think that Christians are somehow inferior to the Jews. No, we're not inferior. Guess what? The Bible refers to the Jews as God's chosen people, but you know what? It didn't say that they were the only chosen people. And Paul is saying that Christian believers are chosen too. And so I want you to know that as a believer, through faith in Jesus Christ, you can walk with your head held high because you are spiritually on the same level with the spiritual Jews. Now you may wonder, why do I keep saying spiritual Jews? Because all Jews are not spiritual Jews. Paul teaches that every Jew is not a spiritual Jew. You got some Jews who are as low life as any human being comes to be. Yes, I said that and I mean that. But the chosen people are not the social Jews. The chosen people are spiritual Jews. And there's a distinction between the spiritual Jews and the cultural Jews or the social Jews. All right. Just as there's a distinction between the children of God and the creatures of God. All right. Now, I want to go to chapter 12 and verses 1 and 2 and ask this question. Does God really care about our physical health, or does he care only about our spiritual health? Well, I'm glad to be able to tell you that God cares for our physical health as much as he does our spiritual health. And the third epistle of John, the third letter of John, this is what it says, beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in good health, just as your soul prospers. So God cares about our good health, and God cares about us in this time of the coronavirus. So, what I want to say to us is that God wants us to follow the leadership of the medical community and do those things that will help us to get through the coronavirus. There are some people who are so disobedient, they don't want to listen. They want to have their way. Sometimes that's the case of the gentleman who lives in the White House. They want to be an authority where they're not an authority. Let me tell you what that's called. That's called ignorance. When you don't know what you're talking about, you're being ignorant to open your mouth. You see, one thing about folks is, as long as you keep your mouth shut, don't nobody know how ignorant you are. But when you open your mouth, everybody finds out. But God wants His people to be obedient. And I'm going to refer you right now to the book of, still in the book of Romans, and in chapter 13. Listen to what it says. And you can look this up, and you can see that this is not me. This is the Word of God. Let every soul, who's not included in every, let every soul be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinances of God. And those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. There are some preachers out there who need to hear that, because they have been holding service and bringing people together. There's a preacher in Louisiana on the news. He has been defying the authorities and holding worship service. And it just came out recently in the news that several people from his church have caught the coronavirus. So you see, he's putting his own people in jeopardy by defying the legitimate government and medical authorities. Friends, we got to learn obedience. If you can't obey the legitimate authority on earth, you sure won't obey the authority in heaven. And so, it hurts me to see so many people be so disobedient, and a lot of the young people who went out on the beaches in defiance of the authorities, several of them have come down with the coronavirus. All right, we're getting ready to wrap this up. But there's one more teaching that I need to share with you. In the 12th chapter of Romans, this is one of the key concepts. The Apostle Paul says, speaking what God laid upon his heart, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Then in verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. What does it mean to be transformed? Well, I did some research on that to get a better understanding. And transformation means two things. Number one, it means repentance. Because when we're born again, remember, we come out of the world and all of this ways of thinking and doing. And when we're born again, our mind doesn't suddenly change. We bring with us the same mind that we had when we were unbelievers. And so, we need a change. We need to think different. We need to start acting different. We need to believe different. So that requires that first of all, we repent. The word repent means to make a U-turn and go back the opposite direction that you were going before. And then after you make the U-turn, you start moving in that new direction. And that's what transformation means. Many people don't realize that when we're born again, we have to give up the old ways of thinking, the old ways of doing, the old attitudes that we came from. The old church had a gospel that they learned to sing. Once they were converted and born again, they said, I looked at my hands looked new. I looked at my feet, and they did too. Ever since that wonderful day, my soul's been satisfied. And so, to be a Christian means we can't keep on doing the things that we used to do. We can't keep on thinking the way we used to think. I used to be, when we got angry at somebody, we'd want to get even. We have to change that. The new way of thinking says you got to love your enemies. Now the corrupt human nature doesn't want to love the enemy. We want to take them down. But the new spiritual nature says, love your enemies. Do good to those who do try to do harm to you. That's what it means to be transformed. Let me share with you the Greek word for transformation. It's a pretty word. And the Greek word is metanoia. Metanoia. And that simply means the two things that I mentioned. One is to repent, turn around from the way you were going and go in the opposite direction, and then to actually move in that direction. You see, some people, the carnal-minded people, they may turn around, then they just stand still. They don't grow. They don't change. They're like a baby in diapers who won't grow up. So when we turn around, then we have to start moving in the new direction, step by step, day by day, week by week, month by month, and year by year. That's what it means to be transformed. And a change of mind, a new mindset. All right? And when we do that, we begin to grow and we begin to learn to think like Jesus Christ thinks. We think his thoughts rather than the worldly thoughts that we have been used to. Well, I told you at the beginning that this was a deep book. And there's so much in there. Paul did some deep teaching in the book of Romans. It's one of the deepest books in the entire Bible. I haven't begun to scratch the surface of the teachings. In reality, when I was in the seminary, I studied the book of Romans for an entire semester of 16 weeks. And here we're trying to cover it in two sessions. So you know there's a lot that I did not get to, but because of the time constraints, I tried to hit the highlights, or most of the highlights, of what Paul taught in the book of Romans. It's been a pleasure of being with you, to share with you from Paul's letter to the Romans. And so I just want to say a brief word of prayer, of thanksgiving. Dear God, we thank you for the great Apostle Paul and for all the letters that he wrote. And we especially thank you, dear God, for the book of Romans and for all of the meaty things that Paul revealed to us in that book. We thank you for each one who has been a part of this lesson today and in the past. And God, may the feeble words that I have spoken be strengthened and empowered by the Holy Spirit, so that your people who were listening in may receive the full meat of understanding of your word, so that we may all grow spiritually from having taken a look at the book of Romans. So we give you thanks, we bless you, we praise you, we honor you. We love and adore you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You going to do an announcement?
I'm going to give one or two brief announcements, and then we will have our concluding benediction. Again, I mentioned to you that Mrs. Brenda Carter, mother, was funeralized this morning. Mrs. Joan Akunikin was her mother's name. And so please lift Sister Carter and her family in prayer. Want to ask you to call in and watch on Facebook Sunday morning, the Sunday morning coming, tune in at 10:25, and the service will begin at 10:30. One of our ministers, Reverend Chandra Cables Webb, will bring the message on this Sunday coming. And we invite you all to tune in and to hear a word from the Lord through his daughter servant, Reverend Cables Webb. Now, the bishop has said to us that our churches are to remain closed through the second Sunday of May. She will let us know if we can open up for the third Sunday, but we won't know that until we get closer to that time. It will depend upon what the governor finds out about the status in the state of Maryland. As you know, the coronavirus in Maryland is still spreading and people are still dying. So don't let your guard down. Thank you. I was having trouble with that word. Don't let your guard down. Continue to wear your mask when you go out. Continue to stay 6 feet apart from other people when you do go out. Don't go out unless you just have to go out. Otherwise, stay in. I know that we get the cabin fever, but listen, friends, we can do this thing. We can do it if we make up our mind to do it. So let's learn to be obedient. Ask God to help you to be obedient and to follow the leadership of those in authority. And so, with those announcements, that's all I have. And so I will give the benediction at this time. Bow your hearts with me in the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace, joy, and happiness this day, tomorrow, throughout the remainder of this week, this month, and this year. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
No matter what you're going through, I know that you can stand, for your life is in His hands. Let's sing it together.